Good morning, saints. Bringing you good news from the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we honor him this morning, the captain of our soul. The one who has allowed us to rise from our sleep this morning, waking us to a day we never seen before. The one who kept us safe all week long from hurt, harm, and danger. As we went about with our daily activities, ordered our footsteps, cleared our pathway, freed our obstacles that could have entangled or entrapped us with the issues of life as we journey toward our heavenly home. We have a God to be thankful for, a merciful God. Again, we coming from the Church Without Walls, Butler, North Carolina. Pastor Maddie Kloop, who is a wonderful woman of God, so humble in her approach, who can preach, teach, and live the Word of God. We thank her for what she has done for this church of God. Today we are living in troubled time. COVID-19 been with us over 6 months now, and still rising in some cases in many of the country. Hatred is on the rise. In 2020, this group against that group. Systemic racism prevailing among us. Many Christians is silent and turning a blind eye to what's going on. The rich is getting richer in these times, and the poor is getting poorer. Many Christians just see what's going on, but they become silent. They just leave it like that. But I don't want to leave that alone. Getting back to what I want to preach about this morning, go with me to Mark 4, 4th chapter, 35 through 41. Mark 35, 4th chapter, Mark 4th chapter, 35 through 41. 4th chapter, 35 through 41. And the same day when the evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind and wave and beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and said unto him, Master, care not that we perish. He arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. He said unto them, why are you so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said to one another, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey? May God bless the reading of his word this morning. I want to talk this morning from the subject, in time of trouble. In time of trouble. A British theologian and preacher, J.S. Joyett, believe, and I tend to agree with him, that inner peace does not come from without tangible things such as cars or wealth. Inner peace comes from an untroubled heart. He also said, quote, if there were 100 people repeating the same sentence, let not your heart be troubled, we would find that 99 of them would put the emphasis on the word trouble, unquote. I feel led to believe this morning that the emphasis should be on the heart. The heart is to be clothed in serenity even when hell is knocking and riding at its very gates. God grant me the serenity to accept the thing that I cannot change, such as trouble that comes my way. If you live long enough, trouble is going to come your way. You don't have to go looking for trouble. Trouble will come and find you. Yeah. Give me this morning, God, the courage to humble myself, yes, and ask him to grant peace unto me in the midst of calamity, in the midst of trouble. God, grant me peace. Every individual created by God is different. Like snowflakes, you'll never find two that are identical. We have different families, different friends, different jobs, and we come from different walks of life. But one thing that we can be sure we all have in common, that we all have trouble.
Amen.
And when the storms of life start billowing up, our resolve is tested. We learn what kind of people we really are. When trouble comes, it's easy to become anxious, angry, panicked, or just frightened. But God offered the word of peace. Peace be still and know that I am God. Psalm 46:10. Even in the midst of life's thunderstorms and hurricanes, tornadoes, and fires, even when the circumstances around us seem at their darkest, someone said, hold on, morning is coming. Hold on, morning is coming. Someone said, the darkest hour is just before dawn.
Yes.
Hold on, a brighter day is coming. We can be at peace because of God. When the bill collector is knocking at the door, when family members are in the hospital, when the doctors give us the worst possible news, we can surrender to the torrents of waves and be swallowed up by the sea, or we can calmly put our faith in God and He will see us through the storms.
Yes.
I know sometimes it seems like we have been in the storm too long. That's old song said, you've been in the storm too long. It seems like forever. So all your nights are filled with fear, and you toss and turn, and you can't sleep, and you're worried about what's going to happen tomorrow. But God is with you. Hold on. God is with you. He knows all of your thoughts. He knows when you turn. He knows when you turn back over. He knows when you turn, toss and turn. He knows about you. God is still with you.
Yes.
In Mark 4, Jesus had been using a small boat as his pulpit, preaching and teaching his disciples. They were learning the mystery of the kingdom of God. But academic faith is not the same as active faith. I said academic faith is not the same as active faith.
Well.
You remember this college student, had just graduated from seminary, and he began to get up and recite the 23rd Psalm. He crossed every T, he dotted every I, and when he finished, they applauded him. And tell me, this old woman got up and she repeated the same Psalm. She didn't dot every T. She didn't cross every I. She mispronounced some word. But when she finished, they tell me the crowd applauded and stood and gave her a standing ovation, and tears were streaming down their eyes. So the young man asked her, what was the difference between my recitation and her presentation? And they told him that you knew the 23rd Psalm. You knew the 23rd Psalm. But she knew the master. That was the difference. That's between academic faith and having active faith. These disciples had the knowledge, but they did not know what to do with it. Their faith was about to be tested. Go with me again back to Mark 4, 35 through 41. I'll paraphrase. Verse 35. It says, on that day when evening had come, he said unto them, let us go across to the other side. Verse 36. Said, and leaving the crowd, they took him, Jesus, with them in the boat. And other small boats were also with them. Verse 37. And said, a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling with water. Verse 38. But he, Jesus, was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him and said unto him, teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Verse 39 says, and he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Verse 40, he said to them, why are ye so afraid? Have you still no faith? Have you still no faith? Verse 41, and they were filled with great fear and said to one another, who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey? Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? The sea which they had set out to cross was the Sea of Galilee. Biblical scholars said it was a freshwater lake in northern Palestine, about 13 miles long and 8 miles wide, and it was heart-shaped. 680 feet below sea level, and was a place of inspiring beauty. However, the mountains surrounding most of the lake said the fierce downdrop of cold air from the higher elevation would swoop down to the warm air in the lower elevation and made it frequently subject to violent storm. This was a perfect storm that night, even though the situation appeared to be threatening. We can see three good reasons why the disciples should have been at peace. The first is that with Jesus on board, they should have found peace in his word, peace in his purpose, yeah, and peace in his presence. Mark tells us that on the day when evening came, Jesus said unto them, "Let us go over to the other side." Verse 35. And in that simple suggestion, the disciples should have found more peace in the most calm seas. Jesus sought to put miles of water between himself and the multitudes of people on the western shore. It was his idea to cross the sea and go into the eastern shore. Here, we see humanity and divinity intertwined with each other. The humanity part of him, Jesus had taught all day. Now he had become exhausted and tired. He knows our limitations. He knows when it's time for us to pull out from our activity for rest and relaxation.
Yes.
Did Jesus know the storm was coming? Of course he knew the storm was coming. The storm would be a part of the day's curriculum. That storm would be a part of the day's curriculum. He could have prevented it, but he deliberately directed the boat into the storm so that he might teach the disciples a lesson. It would help them understand a lesson that they didn't know they needed to learn. Jesus can be trusted in the storms of life. Many people have this mistaken idea that storms only come to their lives when they have disobeyed God or done something wrong. But that's not always the case. In the Old Testament, we read about the prophet Jonah. God commanded Jonah to go to Nineveh to preach to old people. But Jonah hated the Ninevites. So Jonah disobeyed God and went in a different direction. He went down to a place called Joppa and boarded a ship going in the wrong direction. You know, God knows our every whereabouts. He knows where we're going. He knows where we've been. He knows our thought. Jonah thought he could escape God's presence. You can't escape God's presence. So as Jonah boarded the ship, he went down into the bottom of the ship. There he fell fast asleep. And as the ship set sail, a great storm came up, almost tore the ship in half. And the crew began to cast lots on board and to see what was going on. And after God, what was going on? So they found Jonah down in the bottom of the ship asleep. And the captain said, "Why are you asleep? How can you sleep when this storm is raging and going on? How can you sleep?" And said, And he asked Jonah, said, "What God do you serve?" Jonah said, "I serve the God of heaven, the God who made the sea and the dry land. I serve that God." So I ain't on the way for this ship to have peace. You got to throw me overboard. So they threw Jonah overboard, and a whale came by and picked him up and carried him back to dry land after 3 days. So you can't run from God. You can't run from God. Jonah was caught in a storm because he did not obey God. But here, disciples got into a storm because they did obey Jesus.
That's right.
As we read our Bible, we discover that there are two kinds of storms. Storms of correction, and storms when God disciplines us. And two, storms of perfection, when God helps us to grow. That's what this storm was. Jesus' statement said, "Let us go to the other side," was more than just a suggestion. It was a promise. If Jesus said we are going to the other side of the sea, we can rest assured that you will make it to the other side.
Amen.
Let us not forget that this is God, who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we can ask or imagine of. Ephesians 3:20. His commandments are also his enablements. If he said it, it will come to pass, and nothing can hinder the working out of his plan. He did not promise an easy trip, but he did promise a guaranteed arrival at their destination. In my father's house, he said, are many mansions. He said, if it wasn't so, he wouldn't told you so. And on this journey, he didn't promise that it's going to be always easy. He didn't promise us a better road because he didn't have a better road. We're going to find obstacles. We're going to find our road sometimes blocked. Sometimes we have to set back and go back and come back again. Sometimes we fall. But we need to get up and keep pressing toward that heavenly home that he established for us. In my father's house, there are many mansions. I'm looking for that mansion one day. I hope you are too. But on this journey, we got to press on. We got to press on through the storm, through the storms of life. We got to press on. Many times we find ourselves enduring hardship, even suffering. Though we are following Christ in our lives, we must remember that he brought us here and he can see us through.
Yes.
There's peace in God's word. There's peace in his purpose. But the disciples should have secondly found peace in his presence. They should have found peace in his presence. It would be one thing if Jesus had said, you go over to the other side or go across the sea and I'll meet you on the other side. But he didn't say that. He said, let us go to the other side. They could have still trusted in his word and his purpose, but they would have been alone. And who knows what could have happened on their way if they had been alone. So let's go back to verse 40. Still. The word still sticks out in my mind. He says, you still have no faith. So you still have no faith. After all what you have seen, I have done, you still have no faith. They had seen his power demonstrated in his miracles. They saw him make the blind man see. They saw him make the crippled man walk. They saw him take 5 loaves and 2 fish and feed 5,000 and more. They saw him raise the dead. They should have complete confidence that Christ could handle this situation.
Yes.
But for some reason, the disciples did not yet understand that he was indeed the master of every situation, that he rides every wave and storm and plants his feet on every shore. David in his sunset years, when David had become old, David knew what God would do for him.
Yes.
He said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And in Psalm 37, David said, I've been young and I've been old. Said, never have I seen the righteous forsaken, nor a seed begging bread. God will always take care of his children. You had to worry about that. David once said, in peace I will lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, makes me to dwell in safety. Psalm 4:8. How often in trials of life we are prone to imitate the faithless disciples who cried out, Lord, don't you care about us? Of course he does care about you. Too many of us have the mistaken that obedience to God will produce smooth sailing. That's not true. Like I said before, that's not true. As long as we do what God wants us to do, we won't have any trouble. Not true. Man that is born of woman is of a few days and full of trouble. Job 14:1. And Job 5:7 says again, Man is born unto trouble. Jesus warned us saying, in the world you will have tribulation. John 16:33. But he also promised that he will be with us through it all. He won't forsake you. He may not come save when you want him to come. But he's the on time God. I see he's an on-time God. He delivers us out of the storm sometime before we go into the storm. But if we must go into the storm, you can rest assured that he's going to take our hand and guide us through the storm. He's going to be with us through the storm. As it was the three Hebrew boys, they were with them in the fiery furnace. God's going to walk us through the storm. And we're going to come out on the other side of the storm if God is with us. So we don't have to worry about that. And lastly, and finally, the disciples should have found peace in his proclamation. Overwhelmed with compassion for the fearful crew. Jesus go up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Hush, be still." And the wind died down, and it became perfectly calm. And he said unto them, "Why are you afraid? How is it that you have no faith? How is it that you have no faith?" A lot of times when the wind ceases, when the storm is over, the waves and stuff is still tossing about. But on this occasion, the waves ceased immediately. "Peace be still." The waves ceased immediately. In conclusion, alas, there's a song by the name of "Oh, What a Friend We Have in Jesus." The man who penned this song, a whole lot of our hymns were penned with people who had tragedy in their life. The man who penned this song, his fiance, died before they were getting married. And so he penned this song, "Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sin and grief to bear, and what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we offer forward. Oh, what needless pain we bear because we do not carry everything to God in prayer." We bear so much pain. We bear so much needless pain because we don't carry our things to God in prayer. A woman named Helen Stein Rice, the author and a poet, she speaks through a poem, says, "Let not your heart be troubled." She said, "Whenever I am troubled and lost in despair, I bundle all my troubles up and go to God in prayer. I tell him I'm sick, lost, and lonely too, that my mind is deeply burdened and I don't know what to do. But I know he stills the tempest and calms the angry sea. I humbly ask him, in his love, he'll do the same for me." And then I just keep quiet and think only peace, thoughts of peace. And if I abide in stillness, my restless memory cease. What a wonderful poem. What an awesome sight that this must have been that night. The word rebuke was the same word that Jesus often used when casting out demons, which makes me to think that it is possible that Satan was behind this severe storm, attempting to kill Jesus, or at least prevent him from reaching the other side, where the demonic man was possessed with many demons. On the other side, where they was headed, that's where the man was possessed with many demons. And they didn't want Jesus to reach, Satan didn't want Jesus to reach that side. But that didn't stop our Lord. Jesus calmed the wind and the sea by simply speaking the word. Usually after the wind died down, the waves remained rough for hours. But in this instance, everything became calm, immediately stayed that way. When God speak, even the wind and the sea listen. The Bible said, "Praise the Lord from the earth, sea monsters and all the ocean depth, fire and hail, snow, clouds, stormy winds, obey his word." Psalm 48, 7. And 2,000 years later, the word of God has not lost its potency. God's word is just as powerful as ever. And when we read it, it can bring peace to our lives. Within these pages lie God's plan for our salvation, his promise to mankind, his purpose for our lives. When the sea was raging and the billows were tossing high, the disciples looked up and saw danger. They looked within themselves and saw fear, but they failed to look up to see God. The greatest danger is not the wind and the waves. It was unbelief in the hearts of the disciples. Our greatest problem are within us, not around us. And when we are faced with the challenge of life, let us not make the same mistake that the disciples made. This is just one of the many lessons that Jesus taught his disciples on the Sea of Galilee. They already knew that he had authority to forgive sin, to cast out demons, and to heal diseases. Now they discovered that even he has authority over the wind and the sea. This meant that they had no reason ever again to be afraid. For our Lord is in control of every situation. Instead of allowing our fears and doubt to overwhelm us, let us find peace and God's presence and the plan for our life. Let us find peace in His presence in Jesus Christ and His Spirit. Let us find peace that God will always be with us, even until the end of the world. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never leave you. We thank you for this message this morning. May God bless you and heaven smile upon you. I also like to thank Brother Joseph Kruder, who is the mechanic behind this operation. We'd like to thank him too. Wonderful man of God.